Hello, everyone, and welcome to phyloseminar.org, a project supported by the Society of Systematic Biologists. We're in the end of three talks on the theme of bias sampling and phylogenetics. What does it do to our inferences, and what can we do about it? We started with the theoretical perspective from probabilist Leah Popovic. Then we had a talk from Vladimir Menon concerning a new model that explicitly accounts for preferential sampling. Today we have a talk from Nicola and Maio, who will discuss sensitivity of discrete trait methods to sampling strategy. Let me just remind you to please do ask questions either by using the Q&A app, which should be on the left-hand side of your screen, or by tweeting to phyloseminar. As I mentioned, today we have a talk from Nicola De Maio. Nicola did his undergraduate work in his native Italy, then went to Austria to work with Caroline Koissel in Austria. There he did some very nice and important work integrating allele frequency information with sequence data for phylogenetic estimation. In 2013, he moved from to Oxford under a James Martin Research Fellowship. While he's been there, he's been working on a new approach to phylogeography using a structured coalescent approximation, which he'll be telling us about today. All right, thank you, Nicola.
Okay, thank you very much, Eric. It's a really a big honor to be here. And hi, everyone. So let me start by thanking my collaborators, in particular Jesse Wu, Kathleen O'Reilly, and my supervisor Daniel Wilson, who have helped a lot with this project. So what I will be talking about today is mostly phylogeography, and to be honest, this term has a very broad interpretation in literature. So to be more precise, I'm showing here this example. So let's say that a researcher collect samples from different parts of the world. And for simplicity, I have just two broad locations, Africa and Europe. And let's also assume that this researcher has genetic data from each of the samples and that there is no recombination in the, within this genetic data, or at least that you have several loci within which there is no recombination. Then it is possible to reconstruct a phylogeny, or at least to get phylogenetic information of some sort. So what we want to infer using this type of information and using the location of the present location of the samples is about the past geographic information. So the geographical source, in case this is, for example, an outbreak, where it first originated, where it comes from, and migration rates or migration events. For example, here, using parsimony, you would infer that you have two different migration events from Africa to Europe. And I will show a couple of real-life examples from recent literature. So this is the analysis of two bacterial strains of C. difficile, which are really troublesome because they have independently developed drug resistance. And here, what her and colleagues have inferred is both the geographic origin of these of both strains that they infer to be North America, and then several independent migration events to the rest of the world. And the second example is more to focus on the fact that despite we're talking about geography, it doesn't really need to be geographic locations. It can be anything that structures the population in some way. So for example, this is another bacterium, gonorrhea, and here the authors, Grad and colleagues, they consider two different social groups for the host, for humans. So they have men that have sex with men in red samples, and men that have sex with women, these are the blue samples. So you can see that according to the inference, there is structure, but there are also migration events from one group to another. And what these studies have in common, together with most of the recent literature in this topic, is the method that they use, because most of them use what we call the migration approach, which actually is more commonly known as the discrete data analysis or LeMay method or phylogeographic method. And this was proposed by LeMay and colleagues in 2009, and it's been implemented in BAST and BAST2 now. So This approach is very, very popular and has several hundreds of citations, applications. And if you also include different extensions of this model, it's even more. And it is extremely fast. So usually it doesn't carry any additional cost to a standard phylogenetic analysis in BEAST. But there are some concerns in literature, in particular regarding the possible sampling bias that we'll be discussing soon. Also, this method has not been very thoroughly tested. So I will start doing some simulations and checking in some situations how it behaves. So first, to go back into the model, the reason why we call this migration is because it models migration in the same way as genetic mutations are usually modeled. So it assumes that there is a certain prior for the tree, and in most cases, it's assumed that this prior is the standard coalescent, or the vanilla coalescent. So if you want to simulate according to this model, first of all, you would simulate a coalescent tree here. And to get an introduction about the coalescent theory, I suggest you to check the previous talk in this series by Vladimir Minin, that does a really good job. Here we now go on and say that once you have a tree, then you can simulate the evolution of this discrete trait along the tree. In this case, it's geographic locations in particular. And you first sample a state for the root, and then you sample states for the offspring of this root independently on the two offspring lineages, dependently conditioned on the state of the root, of course, and also conditioned on a certain migration rate matrix. So then you go on down the tree and you sample the states at the leaves. So the possible distribution for this model is calculated in the following way. So first of all, what we are interested in is calculating the probability of, so here I'm using a cartoon, I hope it's more clear than just plain equations. So this is the phylogeny, and this is the matrix of migration rates. So what we want to know is the posterior probability of these two quantities, conditioned on the data which we have. So we have genetic data here and geographic data, meaning the present location of samples. And this is broken up into different pieces. So the first we have is basically the Fesselstein likelihood, so the probability of the data given the phylogeny. And the second term is basically the same thing, but instead of the genetic data, now we have the geographic location of the samples. And instead of the genetic mutations, we have the geographic migration rates. And the last two terms are just the priors for the tree and for the migration rate matrix. So here I ignored several terms for simplicity. But you can now compare this to more standard model of migration in coalescent. This is the structured coalescent. And you can see while the posterior, what we want to infer is the same thing, it's broken up in a different way. In particular, the first and the last term are the same, but in the middle here, you have the probability of the phylogeny conditioned on the geographic information and the migration process. So this is because usually in a structured coalescent, the shape of the phylogeny will depend on the migration process. And so it's also informative of the migration process. And secondly, you can see that now geographic location data is conditioned upon here. So this means that this model does not assume that the locations of sampling are in some way influenced by the migration process, while this is the assumption that it's done here for migration. And this is now another cartoon describing the structure coalescent. So in the most simple case, you have just two deans, blue and yellow, and you've specified, so if you want to simulate according to this model, you specify a certain number of samples from these two deans. And what you do next is just simulating a coalescent process along two of these deans separately from each other. This means that lineages in the same dean can find a common ancestor, but lineages in different deans cannot. So according to a certain migration rate matrix, then you have migration events where they have lineages that move from one team to another so that they can coalesce with the other lineages in the other team. And so on. You go backward in time, you keep simulating until you find a common ancestor. So what I did is simulating according to this process. And in this, I start with just two teams and several samples from the two teams, not necessarily the same number, and different migration rates in the two directions. These are the quantities, these migration rates are in particular the quantities that I'm interested in calculating. And what I do, I simulate a phylogeny so that then I can simulate a genetic alignment. And this genetic alignment is what I will use together with the geographic locations of the samples, is what I will use to estimate the migration process using different methods. And of course, I start with migration, so the method I just introduced. And this is now, this first slide is regarding the sampling bias. So according to a structured coalescent, samples are just an arbitrary choice of the researcher. So you can imagine that you don't know anything about the migration process or the prevalence of a certain pathogen around the world, but you decide to sample it from different places, and maybe according to logistic convenience. And according to this idea, to this model, the geographic locations alone should not provide any information of the migration process of the pathogen. And this is what I'm simulating here. So I'm using the geographic location as input to the method, together with a completely non-informative genetic alignment. So you, for example, you can assume that genetic sequences did not provide much much information, or that there is not much variation to have phylogenetic information. And so in, under this hypothesis, what I would expect is that, what I would hope for is that the posterior in a Bayesian analysis is coincident with the prior distribution. So in this plot, I have on the x-axis the log ratio of the two migration rates in the two different directions. And these curves are different probability distributions. So the pink curve is the prior that I'm arbitrarily specifying. And the other two curves, the blue one and the green one, are the posteriors in two different scenarios. In the blue case, I'm using the same number of samples from the two deans. And in the green case, I'm using a very skewed sampling strategy. So 10 samples from one deem and 190 from the other deem. So as you can see, both posteriors are much narrower than the prior. And you also have some kind of shifting depending on the sampling strategy. So if you sample equally from the two deems, you kind of infer or you inform the fact that the two migration rates are probably the same or are similar to each other. While if you sample mostly from one deem, here, you can almost exclude the value zero, which means that two migration rates are the same. So you're basically, you're inferring that two migration rates are different and one is bigger than the other. To better understand why this is happening, you can imagine just a very fast mutation process on a single base between two alleles. Then if this mutates very fast, you expect to converge the observed allele frequency to converge to the frequency to the equilibrium frequencies given by the mutation process, and this is what the method does. It expects the sampled frequencies to correspond to the equilibrium frequencies according to the migration process. And of course, this depends on the intensity of the migration rate. So the higher is the migration rate, the bigger is the bias. And here I'm considering the opposite scenario. So instead of using little information, now I'm giving extreme genetic information. So I'm assuming that the alignment is so much informative that I know the phylogeny perfectly. And this is, in some cases, in certain times, the best scenario for the different methods. So there's no phylogenetic uncertainty, so they're both very fast and they're supposed to have the best accuracy. And what I'm showing here for migration again is the relation between what I simulate the migration rate ratio I'm simulating and what I'm estimating on the y-axis. So each dot here represents a median of the posterior for one run of simulation and inference, with the interval representing the 95% posterior credible interval. So if the estimate was perfect, it would lie on this diagonal dashed line here. But as you can see, the estimate is quite distant from it. So there is little correlation. There is positive correlation, but it's not, I would say it's not so as good as one would hope for. And also the calibration, meaning the number of times that the truth is inside the 95% confidence intervals, is not very high. So this seems to be that there is both some bias and also some missed information by migration. So at least when we are simulating according to the structural coalescent, which assumes that the population size of different deems are constant, we see that migration doesn't have a good performance in terms of lack of bias and accuracy. And there are several other methods which are based on the structural coalescent and which I expect to be much more rigorous in this case. And the problem with these methods is that they are usually very slow and they work fine with two and often three deems, but as you increase the number of deems, they soon become unfeasible to be used. And the most, probably the most efficient of these methods is multi-type tree, implemented by Vaughan and colleagues and in as a package in BIS2. So, as I say, this method is based on the structured coalescent, in particular on the exact implementation of this model. And as such, you wouldn't expect to see any bias. In fact, looking at the same situation as before, without genetic information, you see that the posterior distributions and the prior distribution tend to overlap, although there is a little the difference, probably because the method takes very long to converge, and I had to stop after some reasonable time. But when you look at the accuracy, now giving genetic information, you see that the correlation is much better, and also the calibration is much more acceptable. So the inferred values tend to lie along the optimal line. So we have a method that is expected to be robust in this scenario of migration, but it's too slow to be really used in many or probably most of the cases in real life. So what we try to do is to develop a method that would retain the accuracy of the structured coalescent, but being more being much faster and being applicable to most of the cases in real life. So we developed this approximation, and which we published last year in this paper. And here I'm giving a very brief introduction of how this approximation works, and you can see the detail in the paper. And first of all, let me say that this is very similar to some other approximations which have been done in a phylodynamic context by Eric Voltz and David Rasmussen in different occasions. So what I'm trying to do is going backward in time. So time is on the y-axis and goes backward from the bottom to top. What I want to do is calculate the likelihood of the tree. So the coalescent events in particular here and here. And I want to do this without explicitly parameterizing migration events. This is basically what multi-type tree does, for example. So it given a certain migration history that tells you at each time where each lineage is, it calculates the structural coalescent likelihood. But then this means that you have to explore the space of all possible migration events and geographic locations for the phylogeny with your Monte Carlo Markov chain. So what I'm doing here is I'm trying to using an approach similar to migration in some sense, meaning that I'm integrating over all possible migration histories in at each MCMC step. And to do this, the important thing is are these quantities here. These are probability vectors representing the probability that a lineage is in each of the deem, in each deem. So here we have two samples from the first deem and two samples from the second deem. And as you can see at present, these probabilities are very simple, are just one and zero, one for the deem where they are sampled, and zero for the deem where they are not sampled. But then you start moving backward in time. So you consider the first interval until the first coalescent event. And depending on the intensity of the migration rate outside of the deem, you have that the probability of each lineage to be in each deem changes, and particularly the probability of being in the first, the probability of being in the first deem here decreases from 100% to 90%. And yeah, this is just a cartoon. It's not meant to be accurate. And the same thing happens for the other lineages at this time point. And after the coalescent event, you update this probability, assuming, of course, that coalescence can only happen between lineages in the same deem. And you basically go on like this backward in time with the same, under the same process. And these probability vectors give you the make it much easier to calculate the structured coalescent likelihood. So the before I go on, the one of the approximations I'm doing is that I'm treating each lineage as I go move backward in time, independently of the others when I calculate these probabilities. And this is of course not true, because if lineages are in the same deem, they will tend to coalesce, and otherwise they won't. So it is an approximation, but when you look at simulations, we always found that this approximation is quite good and gives results that are very similar to the structured coalescent.
Sorry, before you move on to the results, it's not completely clear to me how this difference is, how that is different than the migration process. I mean, in migration, you're calculating partial likelihoods of these states as well, right?
Yes, and so one difference is, for example, that we are conditioning on the samples at present, on their location, and then we move backward in time. So,
I mean, don't they do that too for migration?
Yes, some sense, but for example, here, so what makes really the difference is the equations that I showed at the beginning. So the likelihood that I'm calculating is different. So what migration is doing is calculating the likelihood of the probability of the present samples given the phylogeny. And here we are doing the opposite.
Okay,
The other difference is that when I calculate the likelihood at a certain interval here, I'm also calculating the probability that different lineages do not coalesce in this interval.
So the
evolution of lineages is independent within an interval, but
can't have the coalescence.
In total, it's not.
Okay.
I don't know if it makes sense.
Okay, no, that's helpful. Thanks.
Okay. And yeah, basically calibration and accuracy are almost identical to a structured coalescent, which is awesome because we couldn't perform better than that. And the computational efficiency is not much better, not better at all, I would say, in the case we have just two deems. So the computational cost is comparable between multi-type tree and BASTA. But as you increase the number of deems, then let's say multi-type tree becomes less and less feasible to be used, and instead BASTA, the computational cost of BASTA only moderately increases. So this is an example with eight deems, and I run both methods for 2 million steps, which is approximately a similar running time, maybe a little bit more for BASTA, but you can see that the multi-type tree, which is here in the bottom, so this is the trace of the laclude over the MCMC running. So it, after a few hours, it's still kind of looking for the meaningful space, meaningful region of the parameter space. And what BASTA basically converge and gives you meaningful answer. So to conclude this first part, I'm giving a few examples on real data. And I'm starting with an example from Ebola, which is probably not very realistic in the sense that it's very extreme. So what I'm showing here is the phylogeny of the Ebola virus, and for each clade here is representing an outbreak from the one in 76 here until the present one here. And as you can see, the branches within outbreaks are very short, while the branches between outbreaks are very long. And this usually interpreted the simple explanation that this virus resides in some animal reservoir, and then from time to time it's transmitted to humans, and once this happens, then you have human-to-human transmission within an outbreak. So here I was trying to infer this using these two different methods. And as a deem, it's two different populations. I'm treating the human population of host and the animal reservoir instead, so that a migration between the two would be a zoonotic event. And using a structured coalescent methods of both BASTA and multi-type tree, what you tend to infer in this case is that right before each outbreak, you have a zoonotic event. You have a transmission from the animal reservoir to the human host, and that the origin of it is basically the animal reservoir for most of the phylogeny. In using migration instead, you, because of the sampling bias, because basically all the samples come from human, you tend to infer that the virus is always in humans. And if you include a few samples from animals, from bats, that this changes a little bit, but still you tend to infer that the origin is human. So now I move on from to some more realistic cases that still show that there is quite some difference between the different methods. So this is a tomato virus. So it's a tomato yellow leaf curl virus. And it's been, this data set is from the Lefebvre and colleagues. So as you can see, you have different geographic locations representing different colors in the phylogeny. And they are more or less homogeneously represented. And this, I'm coloring the internal nodes of the phylogeny according to the inferred geographic location for migration on the left and BAST on the right. So what you can see is that migration infers with good confidence the ancestral locations and internal nodes. And for the root and nodes close to the root, it's even very close to 100% inferred to BAsia, which, by the way, is also the kind of outgroup location. But when you use a structural coalescent method, and in this case just BASTA because it multi-type tree didn't converge, you have kind of the opposite thing. So after about 50 years in the past, the method is not inferring anything anymore. So it's saying that basically migration happens so fast that at after a certain point, any ancestral location is equally very likely. So if you look at the root, they basically all locations have almost identical probability. I'm not saying that one of these two methods is wrong in this particular case, just highlighting that there can be extreme differences between the two. And so this is another case, and now you see that the phylogeny is much shorter than before. So you have samples very close to the root. So this is a data set of avian influenza by Liu and colleagues. And you can see now the location, the deems are not geographic, but they are bird species. And in particular, there's one which is sampled much more than the others, the Anseriformes. And the root is inferred to be exactly in this species and by migration. When you look at BASTA, you see that the inference is again the same. Basically, so it's the point estimate is the same location for the root, but the confidence in the inference is completely different. And about, it's about with 1/3 probability, more or less. So,
pretty striking how consistent, though, I mean, it seems like the migration is really influenced by what's going on at the root. Or, I mean, I guess the samples that are closer to the root.
Yes, it's, in some sense, it tends to be a little bit closer to the Parsimony inference. It's not entirely clear to me why this is happening, to be honest. But this is, at least in what we tried, it seems to be in the real data sets we explored, seems to be a consistent pattern. So, yeah, to summarize, we have at least under the situation that we have simulated, so the structure coalescent migration, we had a migration that can be strongly biased and not very accurate. So, the structure coalescent methods tend to be better, of course, but they're generally slower, and so what we propose is an approximation that retains the accuracy, but can be applied to most of the real-life scenarios. So to conclude, I want to give a very short hint of what is some work that we are trying to do now in combining together demography and phylogeography. So the reason we are trying to do these two things together, so first of all, what demography is generally considered is the study of changes in effective population size through time. So, for example, if you consider a pathogen, you might want to infer how common it was in certain times in history. And the way this is done is usually by the assumption that the bigger is the effective population size, the longer are the coalescent times. But when you have both a structured population and the changing effective population size, these two things can be, the migration process and the standard coalescent process can be confusing, because when you take samples from different deams, because of the distance from each other, they will require a longer time to coalesce. And so if you take samples from different deams, within the same deam, you will have short coalescent times and you will infer a small NE, small effective population size. If you take samples from different deams, on the other hand, you have long time, so larger NE. And so one has to be careful, and it would be very interesting to see how a method combining both demography and phylogeography would perform. So what I'm showing here is it's very brief preliminary results that have been obtained by Jesse Wu, so a colleague of mine. And this is just results from a few days ago, so we are still trying to work this out. But what she's doing is basically she's looking at two deams with exponential growth, both expanding at the same rate, and you have longitudinal samples, and you have migration between the two deams, and what you want to try to infer is the rate at which the population size is increasing. So what she has here is, on the left, the inference using only demographic model. So model only including the exponential growth and inferring this growth rate. So on the x-axis, you have, again, the truth. And the y-axis, you have the estimate. And the diagonal would be the perfect estimate. So as you can see, there is a tendency to underestimate the growth rate. And this is because the structure of the population will cause, particular top of the root, will cause very long coalescent times that are not expected under a small effective population size. And by using a demographic model and a phylogeographic model, you have some kind of improvement, although there is still some underestimation. And overall, there is an improvement in increase of correlation, decrease of error, and decrease of bias. But we are still working on this. So if there are other questions regarding this first part, and so here's the references that I've been citing so far. Otherwise I would be moving to the second part of my talk, which will be around an application of this method to transmission trees.
Yeah, so we have a question from Peter Ralph. I think he was talking about the examples with the colored trees comparing migration and BASTA, and he asks, in those examples, were the migration rates inferred by migration much smaller?
To be honest, I don't really recall this.
Okay.
Sorry.
But, I mean, yeah. I guess it does seem like they might be. Well, let's see, though. I mean, you said that there were potentially high migration rates near the root for BASTA.
Yeah, so
you said it was close to first money analysis in a sense. So if that was true, then we would expect the migration rates to be lower, I would think.
Yeah, I would absolutely expect to migration to infer lower migration rates. Although it's a bit hard to compare the two. So this is one of the reasons why I'm always comparing the relative migration rates, because total migration rate is modeled in different ways. It's forward in time for migration and backward in time for BASTA. So it's a bit hard to compare. Basically, because they mean different things. But yeah, overall, I would expect to BASTA to infer much bigger number of migration events in this scenario. Yes.
So an artifact of the display, but it is interesting, for instance, for this slide in the lower right for BASTA, we see sort of the appearance of a purple lineage that doesn't seem to actually get sampled at the present day.
This is basically completely random, the colors here. So the width of the branch is representing the confidence that the method.
I see. So there's no confidence at all in
the this narrowness is the minimum confidence there is. So it's like saying that one of these slices is bigger than the other, but it doesn't make any real sense. It's random on which location is sampled more than the others in the posterior, but it's
cool. Okay, I don't have any other questions, and I don't see any others, so maybe we can get a quick taste of the
second part of the talk. Okay, as I shortly mentioned, now I'm trying to use a similar approach to trying to study who infected whom within an outbreak. So you can assume you have certain infection spreading within, for example, an hospital ward, so within a limited setting. And what you might want to study is who is spreading this infection, so who is infecting whom, and where the source of the infection comes from. So this is important because, of course, if you want to stop the spread of the disease, you have to do how it's being transmitted and where it comes from. So this type of methods that try to infer these things usually use, or at least now, they try to use the different type of data. On one hand, you have the genetic data from samples collected from the infected host, and which tell you which pathogen lineages are more closely related to the others. And on the other hand, you have epidemiological data here. So there are many, many different possible cases of how the epidemiological data looks like. What I'm assuming here is that I have a certain time interval for each host. So here time is forward in the y-axis from top to bottom. And this time interval tells me when the host is exposed to the outbreak, meaning when it can be infected and when it can infect other hosts. Okay. So in the recent past, the simple methods using phylogenetics, reconstructing a tree and relating the samples of the pathogen, and then from these trees, reconstructing the transmission tree between the hosts, so who infected whom, have been quite common. But there's a lot of evidence now suggesting that it's not so simple associating from one to the other, without using particular epidemiological data, because there are many complications in real life that can happen. And I'm going to skip a little bit through this very fast. So the point is that all these things that can happen can cause either inconsistency between the phylogenetic tree and the transmission tree, or at least a non-identifiability. So you can have the evolution process, the coalescent process, within a host. So here I'm representing each host as a black rectangle. And so the edges represent the exposure time of the host. The dots represent the sampling of the pathogen, and the lineages represented with red lines. And this is basically a transmission event when one lineage is moved from one host to another. So if you have within host evolutionary process, which is non-negligible, or if you have transmission bottleneck, which means that if the inoculum that is of pathogen that is transmitted from the donor to the recipient host is sufficiently large to contain multiple lineages, then this is also a confounding factor. Or if you have cases which are not being sampled, for example, if they are asymptomatic, this can happen quite often. Or again, you can have problems if you have one host which is infected multiple times by different strains. So overall, one would like a method that works in all these scenarios. But in particular, here we are focusing on within host coalescent and non-sampled cases. So what I've been discussing is in particular three models of evolution of the pathogen within an outbreak. So again, I have time on the y-axis here, and I have hosts represented as different black rectangles. And as before, I have the pathogen lineage and the transmission here, transmission events here. And non-sample cases with a dashed rectangle here. So the first model on the left is the model I'm using to simulate, because it's what I think is the most rigorous model of within host evolution. Within outbreak evolution for the pathogen. So this is the multi-species coalescent model, which is enriched with transmission bottleneck, meaning that when you have a transmission event, you're assuming that the only few individuals are transmitted from one population to another, and then this population is recolonized, and the effective population size increases very fast. This means that when you go backward in time, at this point of transmission, you have a very high probability of lineages coalescing, finding the common ancestor, and then being moved. So this model has basically been used by Xavier Didelot and colleagues, and Matthew Hall and colleagues, who has described this approach in one of the seminars in this series. And here I'm just using this model for simulation, because despite being very inclusive, it's also very computationally demanding. So what I'm using is an approximation based basically on the same concepts of BASTA. So I'm representing again each individual, each case, as a population of the pathogen. And this time, instead of having exposition events representing a transmission, followed by a bottleneck, I'm having a migration event, so one lineage migrating from one lineage to another. And sometimes even more than one migration events. So some of the assumptions I'm doing is that the migration rates are all the same or equal to each other. And this brings to a very big computational saving compared to the, say, phylogeographic use of these approximations. And yeah, I'm calling this approach SCOTTI. So it means structured coalescent transmission tree inference. And the point of comparison with this method is I'm using Outbreaker. This is a similarly fast approach, which is based on a very simple model and which is becoming very popular. And it's been proposed by John Bart and colleagues. And what this model does, it basically it doesn't model within host evolution, so assume that the pathogen is uniform within each host. And this also means that you only can give a single sample from each individual, from each case. And secondly, it assumes that individuals belong to generations. So here you have the first generation on the top, and you assume individuals in the first generation infect individuals in the second generation, and then those infect the individuals in the third, and so on.
Can you say just a little bit about how you deal with the unsampled individuals? That seems pretty tricky.
Yeah, it is. And so what I do is basically assume that there is no epidemiological information for these individuals. And so I'm not setting any, differently from the sampled cases here, I'm not setting any earliest and latest boundary on the exposure times. And the reason I'm doing this is because if you do this, then all non-sampled deems become basically become the same, so they become equal to each other. So when you calculate the probability of a lineage of being a deem on a non-sampled deem, you can assume that the probability of being in any non-sampled deem is the same. And this really makes computations faster.
I get it.
I thought that, yeah, the assumption might that exposure time is infinite, unlimited, might be might cause some troubles in some situations. So the alternative that I allow in the software now is to have regular breaking time, so end of exposure time and start of exposure time. So basically, splitting one unsampled host in several smaller unsampled hosts, but this makes calculations slower, of course.
Cool.
Okay, so I did some simulations, and this is just now the base simulation scenario, and I'm comparing three methods. So the red one is outbreaker, and then I'm using Scotty, both using only one sample per host and using two samples per host. So on the top, I have the accuracy, by which I mean how many times the true infector, the true individual transmitting the pathogen is inferred as a point estimate, so the most likely source of transmission. And as you can see, the accuracy increases using Scotty a bit, but it's improvement becomes much more significant when you use multiple samples per host. So this information is very important. And when you look at calibration, so how many times the truth is contained in the 95% credible set of possible transmitters, you have that outbreaker performs quite poorly. Again, so it tends to focus all the confidence in few estimates. And then I try to change a little bit this, let's say, base simulation scenario. So I try different things like including non-sampled hosts and few or many, or giving more phylogenetic information, for example, giving more substitutions or giving more bases. And here I try to give less accurate epidemiological data, so exposure times, which are not realistic in some sense. And as you can see, all these things, they change the performance a bit, but overall the pattern stays the same over all these simulations. What really makes a difference is here in the last two columns. This is basically when you collect the samples. If you collect the samples, so in the other columns, I'm assuming that the time of collection of samples was basically random along the time in which a host is infected. So if you collect samples very late, you still have the same patterns. But if you collect samples very early, this is the last column, meaning that basically a host is sampled almost as soon as it is infected or as soon as it shows symptoms, then somehow outbreaker performs better and Scotty performs much worse. And we think now that this is because we are not modeling transmission bottlenecks at all. And when you sample very early, so very close to the transmission bottleneck, then this is going to have a much, much bigger effect. So This is now a few applications to real data. This is the foot and mouth disease virus data set that is usually used as a benchmark data set in these kind of studies. And on the left, there is this by Cotta and colleagues. And on the left, you have the results using Outbreaker. On the right, the results using Scott. The main difference you can see is that each transmission event here is represented by an arrow between circles, which are the patient, sorry, the host. In this case, they are farms. And each transmission event is inferred with 100% confidence. So as you can see, there is only one arrow leading to each host. When you look at Scotty instead, you can see the pattern is completely different. So for each infected host, there are usually more than one plausible transmitters. And also within the host, I'm showing the probability to be the index case, for which there is also some uncertainty. So Outbreaker is not using as much epidemiological data as Scott is using. And in fact, some of these inferences, despite being 100% confident, they are not very very consistent with the epidemiological data. And this maybe becomes even more striking in the second example. So this is by Stesser and colleagues. And it's a Klebsiella pneumoniae outbreak in Nepal child care hospital. A neonatal unit. And so you can see on the left, using Outbreaker, that now you do have uncertainty. So many cases, there are two or sometimes three possible donors, possible infectors. But overall, the method infers that the outbreak is made of two components, one single isolate that is not related to the others, and it's probably comes from the independently from the community, and then all other samples which belong to a single outbreak chain. When you look at the inference by Scotty on the right, you see again something completely different. So you do have some cases of direct transmission with good probability, but overall, the method infers that most of the cases are not really related to each other, meaning that there are links of non-sampled cases from one to another. And I think this becomes more clear in the following plot. So this is the phylogeny inferred by Scotty and colored according to the internal hosts. So the host which is inferred to contain the lineages and the nodes of the in the inner part of the tree. So what you can see that there are some cases where you infer direct transmission here, but for most of the tree, the host containing the lineages is inferred to be a non-sampled case represented here with NS. And so instead of having a single outbreak, what Scott is inferring is that you have basically one, two, and at least three different sub-outbreaks, which are related to each other by at least a few links of non-sampled hosts. Yeah, so this could be interpreted in different ways. One could imagine that there is environmental contamination, for example, which is similar as you would expect with many non-sampled hosts, or maybe these are independent reintroduction of the pathogen from the community.
That's interesting. I mean, I guess. Yeah. I mean, that's an interesting interpretation of non-sampled hosts. I mean, I definitely can see that if you don't have transmission, then you can think of it as a non-sampled host somehow way back in time. But I mean, how do you make the distinction really between like an authentically non-sampled host? Or maybe I'm just not understanding how it works.
Let's say it's you can, for example, if you have environmental contamination, if there is a single source which is not a host, it's more like an environment, then it's very hard to distinguish this from a big population host, like a community. So in general, this method does not even try to make the distinction. It's more trying to understanding which direct transmissions are plausible and which are not.
Okay, that's helpful.
And yeah, the last thing I was forgetting to say is that this inference is actually is supported by some of the epi data, because you can see these hosts belong to four different groups. And between these groups, there is quite long gaps of time where no sampled host is present. So this means that the pathogen necessarily has to be present in some non-sampled host in order to exist.
While I have you interrupted, you mentioned additional epi data. I mean, is there some way to implement, like, to put that into the inferential model as some priors or something on, like, you know, for instance, we saw this ventilator being used first and then this other one second, therefore we sort of have a prior assumption that this one happened before that one or some other thing like that?
So right now I'm allowing just very hard priors on this time in which hosts can be infected. So like an earliest time and the latest time. And so changing these values does not seem to affect the method very much. So this is one of the columns I had in the simulation before. So this information is very important, but it's the method seems to be robust to some error. Specifying a prior, it's not yet implemented, I'm afraid. But yeah, it surely will be very interesting. And we are thinking about it right now. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I'll just conclude here and make a summary. So I've shown you different models, different methods to infer transmission between hosts, and I've shown you that different methods can have can draw very different conclusions. So this method I'm proposing models between host evolution and non-sampled cases, and is implemented in a BAS2, so it's called Scotty. What I'm trying to do now is to improve the accuracy of the method, including transmission bottlenecks and maybe also specifying priors for the epidemiological data, and maybe contact networks and these kind of more complex things. So yeah, these are the references, and thank you very much for listening. Please ask questions if you have any. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. That was a very interesting talk. And I'm glad to see this sort of inference going into the who transmitted whom. One quick question. I mean, you said that multiple samples, I mean, you showed with your simulations that multiple samples made a huge difference.
Mm-hmm.
Can you say a little bit about why you expected that to, or why that makes sense?
Well, for a start, you get a much better picture of what is the within-host coalescent process, so how fast you expect the coalescence within-host to happen. And sometimes it also, so because of the complexity I've shown you before, it simple phylogenetic tree with one sample per host sometimes can be very little informative. And in some sense, by including more samples, this the phylogenetic tree becomes much more informative of what the migration process might have been. So what the time of migration might have been.
Yeah. I mean, so for instance, if you implement the bottlenecks, would you expect that to make the single individual or the single sample more accurate? Because that would sort of push down.
I would expect both cases to get more accurate in similar ways. So that using multiple samples, there is more information, so you would expect more accuracy. And independently by the approximation you're using, I think.
And just sort of a curiosity question. I mean, so when you're dealing with bacterial data, how do you do it? I mean, is the SNP data, like, how do you think about it? I mean, do you restrict your data columns to just informative sites, or how do you deal with the fact that most sites are invariant when in bacteria?
So the typical procedure in BEAST is that you include all sites, both viable and non-viable. And yes, in some cases, it can be too much data, so maybe the file can be too big, but you can use a very concise format, so only include the variable sites and the number of fixed sites, basically, and you have exactly the same inference. So yes, you can include just the variable sites as long as you know how many constant sites you have in the genome,
mm-hmm.
which is important information to know the molecular clock and such.
Yeah, and I mean, so and that's the state of the art. I mean, there's not, for instance, like, I don't know, it just seems like the, you know, it's a rather different situation than the situation that phylogenetics was typically conceived for, which is sort of very ancient divergences where you have sort of a pretty non-trivial amount of mutation per site.
Yeah. So usually you have few dozen SNPs. At least this is the kind of data sets I've been looking at. So there is a lot of phylogenetic uncertainty. Yes.
So beyond some of the things that you mentioned, like what are some, I mean, as far as like priors on, like epipriors and things like that, what's the sort of next step for this type of inference, this epidemiological inference? I don't know, thinking like 5 years down the road or something.
I'm sorry, the last?
You're thinking 5 years from now or 10 years from now.
Yeah, I don't really make such long plans, to be honest.
Okay.
Thinking of about 1 year, 2 years plan, it's surely trying to make the method more accurate. So what we are trying hard to do is to include the bottlenecks right now. And so this would result in not only a model for transmission, but also a model for colonization, for example, so an extension of the structure coalescent.
Cool. All right, that was a great talk. I don't see any other questions, so thanks again.
Yeah,
and
thank you much.
The next set of talks are going to be about protein structure. We're going to have Jesse Bloom, Klaus Wilke, and Richard Goldstein, but I don't have all the abstracts yet. But, that should be a cool session. All right, thanks again.
Bye-bye.